Hello, everyone. Welcome to this edition of PrEP Learning Network. My name is Amkhelan Kigana, but please call me Sasha, and I'm not riding alone. I'm with my amazing co-host, and I will hand over to her to give us some opening remarks for today's learning lab. But before that, please would you introduce yourself by writing your name, organization, and country in the chat. Over to you, Saiqa.
Hi, everyone, and thank you for joining today's Global PrEP Learning Network, entitled Beyond Engagement, Bringing the Power of Young People to PrEP Research and Programs. This webinar has been organized with the aim of shedding light on various ways in which young people are contributing to research and programming. And we have a fantastic lineup of speakers and panelists who are going to share their experience from different countries, different cultures and regions, providing examples of engagement and insights across PrEP access and HIV prevention. We want to emphasize that meaningful youth engagement is not just about involving young people as passive participants. It's about creating a space like this webinar where voices are heard, ideas valued, and contributions shared and genuinely integrated into the research and programming process. You are going to hear from two main groups, MOSAIC's NextGen squad and the Chicago-based PrEP4Teens team. The NextGen squad is a team of youth advocates who've been hired as project staff in 9 MOSAIC countries to help shape and inform MOSAIC activities. And PrEP4Teens is an initiative to educate LGBTQ plus teens in the Chicago area about PrEP and empower them to access sexual health care through a blend of art and advocacy. So we've got a great lineup, and I'm going to hand over back to Sasha to take us through the agenda.
Thank you so much, Saiqa. Next slide, please. So in today's agenda, we are going to have welcome introductions, which I feel like we're about to cover. And from that, we'll hand over to Mashadi to tell us more about introduction to NGS, NGS support team and guiding principles of MOSAIC, and jump over to LVCT Health, where Mercy will be giving us a presentation about demand creation and PrEP positioning strategy in MOSAIC. And after that, it's examples of meaningful youth engagement in Catalyst Launch, delivered to you by Havana Mtetwa and Mtebo Lerotodi. And then from there, it's PrEP4Teens, whereby Jim Pickett from AVA will be giving us the presentation. And soon after that, we're going to have just 5 minutes to check if everybody is on par with us. And then we're jumping straight into the panel discussion, whereby I will be leading that talk. And then it's audience question and answers. And then we are closing. Next slide, please.
So I'm delighted to co-moderate today's session with Sasha. And Sasha's a research assistant at BITSRHI. She's on the Catalyst study in South Africa. And she's also an HIV prevention ambassador, which she started at BeWise, which is a government-owned platform focused on sexual and reproductive health for youth. At VITSRHI, Sasha's transitioned from her role as a field worker to becoming a research assistant and supporting the MOSAIC NextGen squad and providing technical assistance on implementing the HIV prevention ambassador training in Zambia.
Hi. And I am honored to be sharing this platform with the one and only Professor Saiqa Mullick, which is a medical doctor with a PhD in infectious disease epidemiology from London School of Hygiene and Tropical Medicine. She is also a principal investigator on a number of trials evaluating integrated service delivery approaches for young women. And over the past 5 years, she has served as deputy director for the Option Consortium and is currently a member of the Strategic Leadership Group of the Consortium. And she is my boss's boss's boss. Next slide, please. All right. So in today's presenters, number one, we're having Mashadi. Mashadi is a project manager at VITSRHI and member of the MOSAIC NextGen Squad support team. and she is supporting two big projects in the RHI, which are Project PrEP and MOSAIC. And then after that, we have Mary Mercy Nihishabo. She is the president of the Nairobi Youth Advisory Council and a former member of the Dowsy Task Force and under her voice fund. And she is also a community life, oh, sorry, she's adolescent and young people liaison officer at LVCT Health. And we also have Havana Mtetwa from PZ in Zimbabwe. Havana is pursuing a Bachelor of Laws and Law Honours at the University of Zimbabwe, and she's also part of the NextGen squad, and she has also contributed in the development and field testing of the third edition of the Ambassador Training. Next slide, please. We also have Ntebo Lerotodi. She is based in Lesotho, working for JAPIGO. She is a youth advocate, and she has also volunteered at the Lesotho Planned Parenthood Association as an HIV testing service counselor and a general counselor. She's also part of the NextGen squad. And moving over to Jim Pickett. Jim Pickett is the community principal investigator for Chicago's PrEP4Teens research and implementation project. He is also a senior advisor with AVEC and directs the Choice Agenda listserv and monthly webinar series. And we also have Sadia Haidari, which she is a PrEP4Teens youth leader. And Sadia is originally from Chicago and is currently a second year student at the University of Michigan and pursuing computer science and medical anthropology. With that said, I would like to jump straight to our first presenter, which is Mashadi. Mashadi, over to you.
Thank you so much, Sasha. Thank you, Saiqa. I'm very happy to be here today talking about one of my absolute favorite topics, which is meaningful youth engagement. So our presentation will focus on MOSAIC as well as MOSAIC's youth structure known as NGS, the NextGen Squad. And we will also talk about how the project takes meaningful youth engagement to a new level. So that's the title of our presentation. As Sasha said, I'm Mashadi, and I'll be co-presenting with Mary Mercy, Havana, and Nzibo. Thank you. Next slide, please. So before we even go into the NGS, to understand how the NGS was formed and how the youth structure works, we need to start by first understanding what MOSAIC as a project is. And MOSAIC stands for Maximizing Options to Advance Informed Choice for HIV Prevention. That's quite a mouthful. And is a project that's funded by PEPFAR through US aid. The project aims to help ADYW, which stands for adolescent girls and young women, to prevent HIV by accelerating the introduction and scale up of new PrEP products. And MOSAIC is committed to a process of creating change that is principled, but also very importantly, led by and designed with young people, and also acknowledges their lived realities and the lived realities of those it serves and collaborates with. And as I mentioned, the project's goal is to accelerate access to new PrEP products. Currently in market is oral PrEP, and very importantly and very excitingly, near to market is the PrEP ring and care PrEP. So the goal is to accelerate access to new PrEP products towards a multi-method market. Next slide, please. So MOSAIC is guided by principles that not only inform how the project designs and implements programs and research, but also guides how the team and MOSAIC partners operate and collaborate. And we have five main principles that guide all of the work that we do, which you see on the screen. And the first one is examine and challenge power. So in order to change the harmful systems and norms that continue to fuel the HIV epidemic, we must first examine and challenge power and foster healthy relationships and interactions that enable us to scrutinize and in some cases, to disrupt existing binaries and hierarchies. The second principle is to make labor visible. To be the change that we want to see more immediately, we must start by valuing and respecting the labor and contribution of every single person working to make MOSAIC a successful project. And there's really no action item, there's no role or responsibility that's too small. Everything that everyone does to contribute to the project is important. The third guiding principle is embracing diverse perspectives. It's important so that individuals with diverse perspectives and inputs have the opportunity to share them in ways that allow for full, authentic participation. Our fourth guiding principle is prioritizing responsiveness to the local context. And although HIV is a global epidemic, addressing it effectively requires that we understand and respond to local priorities, preferences, and lived experiences of the people in that local context. And the fifth guiding principle is centering the safety and well-being of those most affected, which means upholding each person's right to security and well-being, which creates an enabling environment for HIV prevention that increases the safety and affirms the dignity of those who are most affected by HIV. Next slide, please. So I'm going to start by providing a definition of meaningful youth engagement. I hope you're seeing that we're going towards talking about the NGS. But according to the USAID Youth and Development Policy, meaningful youth engagement is an inclusive, intentional, and mutually respectful partnership between young people and adults where power is shared and all contributions are valued. And it's also a partnership where young people's ideas, perspectives, skills, and strengths are integrated into program design as well as the delivery of these programs. It's really important that young people are at the forefront of making decisions, of coming up with ideas, because they know best when it comes to what is going to help them and their peers and their communities. And on the left, you'll actually see a few ways that our NGS define meaningful youth engagement. So being seen as an equal, for ATYW being seen as well as a community as shared partners and leaders, especially in the Mosaic Project. The involvement of young people's ideas, expertise, and experiences, and also meaningful youth engagement is important for young people because their perspectives and input have the power to impact the decisions that will affect their communities. And in large part, this will affect the perception and uptake of PrEP. Next slide, please. So then we get to the next gen squad, NGS. I call it the best squad to ever do it. And Mosaic's main youth engagement mechanism is the Next Gen Squad, the NGS, which is the project's youth advisory committee. And the NGS is extremely important because as a group, they help shape and inform Mosaic activities. The squad is a team of youth advocates. We currently have 12 youth advocates from 9 different countries. They're all under the age of 30, and they've been hired as project staff in each of these countries that you see on the screen. So Eswatini, Kenya, Lesotho, Namibia, Nigeria, South Africa, Uganda, Zambia, and Zimbabwe. And the NGS holds Mosaic accountable to its plans, to its actions, and monitoring, evaluation, and learning efforts to ensure that as a project, we're remaining responsive to young people's needs, their preferences, and lived experiences, that we're inclusive of the diversity of ATYW in all of the work that we do, and that we're meaningfully engaging young people in research and research utilization. Next slide, please. And these are our 12 youth advocates, all such incredible, very dynamic team of our Mosaic team, and they are from the 9 countries that I've mentioned. We've got Adobe from Nigeria, Tlili and Chantala from South Africa, Phoebe, Namibia, Havana and Sanella in Zimbabwe. We have Louis in Zambia, Maggie and Mercy are in Kenya, Zebos in Lesotho, Rubuna in Uganda, and we have Nolwazi in Eswatini. Next slide, please. So to ensure that we're engaging NGS in a way that is meaningful and focuses on capacity building, we have different levels and structures of support for them. So obviously at the very core is NGS. Then we have the support team. I'm a member of the support team. There are the members, Alison, Shaila, and Kunda. And we provide overall coordination of activities. So we do regular check-ins. We provide support before, during, and after requests that are sent to the NGS for support. We then have their mentors and supervisors, and they provide further learning and capacity or skills building opportunities in country. And they reinforce the learnings that the NGS is getting on a global level. We then have the Gender and Youth Central Team, and this team provides additional support and oversight for all activities that NGS does. And then we also have the MOSAIC Consortium at a broader level. As a project, it's very easy to reach out to anyone on the project in any country for any assistance or support or guidance. So we have that as well. And an important note is that the structure highlights support for global activities. When it comes to in-country activities, the NGS mentor supervisor will come before the support team. Next slide. So what does meaningful youth engagement look like on MOSAIC? So firstly, full participation in youth leadership. Our aim here is to maximize the contributions of all NGS members by using an approach that ensures that activities are values-driven, that NGS members, their mentors and supervisors, and all staff and partners have core skills, and to ensure that best practices and engagement are implemented. And in terms of values-driven activities, we need to ensure that values are critically examined, that time and energy is invested, that the culture of urgency is shifted, that opportunities are prioritized, and that lived experiences and expertise are valued, and that feelings are validated. Next slide, please. So thank you very much. I hope everyone is still listening. I'm going to call on Mary Mercy from LBCT Health in Kenya to talk about demand creation and PrEP positioning in MOSAIC.
Hi, everyone. So I'll first give a brief description of what demand creation and what positioning is. So for just to define what demand generation is, it is the process of creating awareness and demand for your products. So in this regard, we're talking about the new PrEP HIV prevention for young women. And for positioning, it is a marketing strategy that determines the tone, the look, and the feel of marketing and communication materials. It provides a roadmap to what we say and how we say it. So a positioning strategy would be the creative element that consumers ultimately encounter. It's a strategy that provides guidance regarding how to tell a story externally. And how can members use this strategy? It is intended to be used by implementers to guide their development of national communication strategies, their demand generation campaigns, or other marketing materials for the expanding category of PrEP products. As the NGS, how have we been part of this process? We have been engaged at multiple points in this process. I was privileged to be present during the inception meetings, but subsequently we have had several workshops, virtual workshops, where regular feedback from the NGS, we were giving regular feedbacks to the demand generation team. So in the first workshop, we focused on reviewing, refining, and prioritizing insights based on previous research and campaigns. And in the second workshop, we focused on refining, critiquing, and potential positioning statements based on inputs from the country teams and the NGS. And in between the workshops, you were able to do presentations to our various MOH, Ministries of Health. And also we had an engagement with adolescent girls and young women who are advocates from Kenya and from South Africa. As towards the end of the positioning, as we almost we're almost at the end of to develop the final strategy, positioning strategy, and to affirm that what has been put is right and is resonant to adolescent girls and young women, focus group discussions were held in Kenya, in South Africa, and in Zimbabwe. Next. There are some of three territories that were there are three territories that were assessed in each of the three countries. So in discussions in the groups with the AGYWs was to optimize the direction that it is relevant and resonant to these young women. Three creative interpretations of the positioning directions were presented to groups of AGYWs, and they assessed and evaluated the key performance metrics. Here are some of the messages that were tested out. So in one country, in all the countries, we tested out these three posters. So the one that says that I choose me, and the second one says I am my own hype girl, and the third one says I can do great things. And in these feedback sessions, we were able to engage a variety of adolescent girls and young women and get feedback from them to see whether all these messages that we have created, all the feedback that we have been providing as the NGS, that is relevant and is true to the young women at the community level. So next slide. So we can see this has been the process for the positioning, where we first had the core team meet. So where I've said I was able to join. And so throughout this process, we have been involved in, at three stages where we engaged young women in the the first workshop and the second workshop. And then also when we were engaging advocates in the positioning session with advocates from Kenya and South Africa. We have been engaged throughout this process, and feedback is not just through virtual sessions, but we are also able to guide on how the messages feel and how the messages read and what language would be best to be used and reach more young people, including how they are, including the delivery system. Next slide. Thank you. I'll hand over back to the next presenter, who is Havana Mteta from PZAD.
Good afternoon, everyone. We'll be discussing what Catalyst has done for youth meaningful youth engagement. Next slide, please. Catalyst stands for Catalyzing Access to New Prevention Products to Stop HIV. And this study is under the MOSAIC project. It aims to achieve the three objectives that are on screen right now. The first one being characterizing the implementation of an enhanced service delivery package for PrEP choice. The second, to describe the patterns of PrEP use and the use of effectiveness in the context of PrEP, and to describe clinically relevant and indicators amongst PrEP users. Basically, Catalyst is aimed to see how young people use PrEP, what makes them switch to new products, stop using PrEP, and how to make it more appealing and more inviting for young people. And that is the reason why we are championing meaningful youth engagement, to ensure that the work that we do is not for naught, but for the benefit of everyone possible that is in the target market. Next slide, please. So the Catalyst study actually was launched this year with the Lesotho being the first on the 30th of May, and South Africa being the most recent country to launch the Catalyst study. It's a great success, as each country that has started off with the intention of beginning the Catalyst study has gained approval and has actually begun with stage one, where oral PrEP and the PrEP ring are the first to be offered up in each of these five countries in each of their sites. And then stage two is something that we look forward to greatly, with the CAP PrEP being offered at that stage. It's yet to happen, but we look forward to it. Next slide, please. So meaningful youth engagement when it comes to Catalyst has really seen each stage of the study. When we say pre-launch, we're meaning to say that meaningful youth engagement was there before the study was even launched. For example, when it comes to reviewing the Catalyst protocol prior to the study launch, most of these countries actually had youth Catalyst engagement meetings to ensure that every aspect is touched on, that the young people speak for themselves. And this really created a sense of ownership and purpose. You see it in meetings when they say, yes, this is what we agreed on. Thank you for doing that. So here we've got the second one being strengthening the study's connection to PrEP users. This was done through the development of youth advisory boards. I can speak for Zimbabwe, where each site, each of the six sites, has a standalone youth advisory board, because we understand that young people are not a homogenous group. They are all very different. What works for one rural girl will not work for another girl in the urban areas, and what works for them will not work for somebody in the peri-urban. And that also is different from the nuances of education and lived experiences. Then the last one would be the recognition of well-being of PrEP end users at study sites. This was seen through the co-facilitation of catheter study data collection training. This was done with the NGS. And I can speak for Zimbabwe, in which Sanele and I were both part of these trainings, where we both got the training to do with quality improvement and trauma-informed approach training. Next slide, please. So when it comes to transitioning to meaningful youth engagement and study implementation, we have seen that each aspect needs to be touched upon, but not just in the relevance of the study, but also when it comes to being engaged by the Ministry of Health. This is seen through the co-facilitation of technical working groups, in which Sanele and I were invited to the Ministry of Health and Childcare meetings to do with TWG meetings and National AIDS Council, as well as contributing to conferences such as the SA AIDS, in which we contributed to transcending tokenism, optimizing the quality and impact of HIV prevention implementation, science through meaningful stakeholder engagement. Really, you can see that meaningful youth engagement has been a part of each aspect from before the launch, during the launch, in big level meetings, and every other aspect. I would like to take this on to Nsebo for her to continue on with this.
Thank you, Havana. Good morning and good afternoon, everyone. My name is Nsebo Lokototi, and I work as a youth advocate at Jakaibo Lesotho. So I'm going to take you over on how we have engaged young people in our respective countries in Catalyst Study Advisory Board. So as the Catalyst Study Advisory Board, we have established the Community Advisory Board and the Youth Advisory Board. And also this structure is tailored to the needs and the context of each country, and the terms of references are established collaboratively with each group. So as MOSAIC, we have established a Community Advisory Board and Youth Advisory Board in Eswatini, Zambia, Kenya, Lesotho, Zimbabwe, Uganda, and we are yet to establish the Community Advisory Board and Youth Advisory Board in South Africa. So like Havana indicated, there's advisory boards on each side in each country, and these advisory boards are very diverse. Next slide, please. Okay, so now I'm going to talk about how we have formed this advisory board. What are the youth advisory board? So the youth advisory board is comprised of young people who are between the age of 10 to 30. And these people are from the key population-led, youth-led, and HIV-proclaiming organizations, which include LGBTQI plus community, individuals with disabilities, PrEP users, and female sex workers. So the members of youth advisory board are young people who are willing and able to advocate for choice and youth-friendly services such as HIV prevention, sexual and reproductive health rights. These young women are women who are very passionate about youth empowerment, gender equality, and they are focusing on local concerns that young people face. And the goal for Youth Advisory Board is to ensure that the voices of the young people are understood and considered at all levels, and they are supported, and they support the effective and the meaningful participation of young people in MOSAIC implementation. Going on to Community Advisory Boards, the Community Advisory Board comprised of community leaders, including the retired professionals, community healthcare workers, priests, traditional doctors, and etc. So we leveraged on the existing healthcare health center committees to establish the community advisory board at each site in different countries. So the goal of a community advisory board it's to serve as the advocates for the community and to facilitate a transparent, meaningful, collaborative, mutual, beneficial, and sustainable relationship with stakeholders during Catalyst Study implementation. Next slide, please. So what are the functions of community advisory boards? So the community advisory board serves as a channel for information exchange between MOSAIC and users by making sure that the community members, including young people, are actively involved throughout the research and product introduction. And they also provide the input on local relevance and acceptance. And they ensure the safety of study participants by providing the oversight and the direction. And lastly, they represent the interests and the needs of end users and the community and community stakeholders. And here we have the picture of the Lesotho Community Advisory Board. Next slide, please. Okay, so the functions of Youth Advisory Board. So Youth Advisory Board members meet quarterly, where they address the concerns, the barriers, and the issues of adolescent girls and young women related to the product introduction. And they also participate in the capacity strengthening activities and service delivery trainings. And Youth Advisory Board members also support the planning. They organize and host the youth workshops to mobilize the participation in catalyst activities. And lastly, they contribute to the development and the review of catalyst demand generation materials and activities. Next slide, please. And I believe this will be my last slide. So what are our key takeaways from meaningfully engaging young people in MOSAIC and Catalyst? So when you talk of meaningful youth engagement, we're talking about the commitment to a process of creating change that is principled and led by and designed with young people. So after establishing the community advisory board, we noticed that this community advisory board includes parents and caregivers, and they give the project visibility and representation at community level. Also, we have learned that it is very important to continuously engage with young people to fully incorporate their inputs and instill ownership in the project. And it is very important to clearly articulate the roles and the roles of youth advisory members and community advisory boards. And lastly, it is very important that when we include young people, when we facilitate the meaningful youth engagement opportunities at various professional or academic levels. Thank you. Over to you, Mashadi.
Thanks, Sintibo. I guess we're going to move into the next presentation.
Good morning, afternoon, and evening, everybody. This is Jim Pickett with the PrEP4Teens Project and the Choice Agenda. Many of you may know me through that. I've been a longtime fan of MOSAIC and a big fan of the NextGen Squad. And I am really excited to be joined today by my colleague on the team, Saiqa Hedri. So let's just go ahead and get started. You've already heard a little bit about me, but today I'm going to be talking really focused on the PrEP4Teens Project in Chicago. And joining me in the discussion is Saiqa. Saiqa, you want to say something?
Yes. Hi, everyone. My name is Saiqa Hedri. I'm from Chicago. I've been with the PrEP4Teens Project for 3 years. I joined when I was 16, and I'm really happy to be able to continue with them. And I'm currently an undergraduate student at the University of Michigan.
Thank you, Saiqa. So here's what we're going to take you on our journey through today. We're going to give you a little bit of background on the project and just talk briefly about some of the research we've done to get us to this place. We're going to focus in on a couple of creative think tanks, of which Saiqa was involved, and as well as you'll hear from Leo Martinez later on the panel, who has also been involved in our think tanks for the last couple of years. Then we're going to lay out what our strategies for teens are, for PrEP4Teens, and we're going to talk a bit about what we plan to do for our launch. So we haven't launched yet. You're getting a little sneak peek, but we're hoping to do that, hoping and praying that 2023 quarter four will be magic. So the last several years, we've worked with a number of partners. Leading the brigade has been Northwestern University, but we've worked with local organizations like AIDS Foundation Chicago, a small consulting company run by Black queer people called People Who Care, Lurie Children's Hospital, Cook County Core Center in Chicago, and a variety of other partners in community. And so this all really began a few years ago with grant writing and brainstorming. I'm sure you're all very familiar with that. And then we actually launched our project in November to do a needs assessment with young people, specifically teens and stakeholder adults. We had planned to do focus groups in person, but as everyone will recall, COVID hit us. So we moved our focus groups into asynchronous online focus groups, and our stakeholder interviews were conducted over Zoom. We did focus groups with 50 teens, and we talked to stakeholders, about 30 of those. I will say it was important to hear from stakeholders, but we really prioritized what we heard from teens in terms of what they want to see in PrEP marketing, PrEP social marketing, how they want to be engaged, what's important to them, et cetera. And I will say that once we launch, we think we will be the first campaign focused on teens in the entire United States with regard to PrEP, that there has been no PrEP social marketing specific to teens as of yet. So we analyzed that data, we synthesized that data, and then in the spring, or that spring and summer, we recruited a think tank with gender diverse young people, teens in the Chicago area, and they looked at the data, they looked at the synthesis of the data, and they came up with all kinds of ideas about how we should engage teens through social marketing and communalization to get them interested in to know about PrEP. And Saiqa, as she mentioned, was part of that think tank, and Saiqa is going to give you a little tidbit of what that was like. Go ahead, Saiqa.
I thought that the think tank was a really informative part of how the PrEP project would work for us. I think that we ended up designing these profiles of people that we would picture that would need the PrEP project in Chicago or would be interested in it. I remember we created a character named Angel, and it was someone that we would consider, oh, what kind of accessibility could we include in this messaging so that it would be reachable to someone like Angel. So we thought about Spanish speakers all over Chicago, what it's like to be a first generation individual in Chicago, and things like that.
Thank you so much for that, Saiqa. And so, yes, Saiqa and her team created this think tank creative brief. And in that brief, includes everything from messaging direction to what kind of fonts they wanted, the kind of color scheme they wanted to focus on. Saiqa mentioned creating, really thinking about who our sort of customer profile is. And it was really quite astounding. This creative brief that they put together is something that you would see coming out of an ad agency, right? A professional ad agency. And this was done by five or six young people, with leadership from People Who Care, the small Black-led queer consulting agency here in Chicago. So we pulled that sort of creative brief ideas together, and then we put them up online and did a community feedback survey with young people in Chicago to see what they thought about these directions. And the directions were quite well supported. They had some critiques and some ideas, but they really liked the direction that they were going, the kind of focus on empowerment and awareness and choice and freedom and safety. A lot of words that we heard from the NextGen squad earlier really resonated with them, and they liked the kind of the color scheme. They liked the direction we were going. So in the meantime, my colleague, Catherine McCabagall, and I, who is the academic PI at Northwestern, who's working with me on this the last several years, we spent a lot of time looking for funding, as you can all imagine how fun that is, and developing and nurturing partnerships and doing some presentations. And then last summer, we reconvened the think tank that included Saadia and Leo, and we further iterated out the ideas that they came up with the year before. So we really wanted to flesh out some of these ideas around the website, what would it be included in the website, what kind of language we're using, how do we describe the various PrEP modalities. And I should say, the United States, we have available the pill and the shot. We do not have the ring. And so that was a really exciting time. And I'm going to turn it back over to Saadia to give a little bit of insight into what that second think tank was like.
The second think tank was more about making it physically accessible. After we had done the first think tank and we had made our messaging very clear of what we wanted, it was more now about how are we going to get the word out. So we decided on starting a Discord channel, which we're hoping to launch. And that Discord channel was integral to understanding how teens communicate and how, if we want this to be a teen-based project, it's important that we know the platforms that teens use. And from that, we also decided, oh, we would do social media, which would be TikTok, Instagram, and then also making sure that we have murals in the areas where there's the highest need for the PrEP project and where we see the highest rate of HIV infection. So we wanted to make murals interactive with QR codes on them, maybe having TikTok dance challenges surrounding those murals so people are encouraged to go to those spaces. And so we were really able to build that idea and kind of start to develop the materials for getting these things out.
Excellent. Thank you, Saadia. So I'm going to tell you about all those strategies in a second, but just a few months ago at the top of the year, really the first quarter around March, we went from having zero grants to bring all of this to life to getting four grants. And we got two grants that were specific to implementations from a local foundation in Chicago and the Chicago Department of Public Health. And then we got two more grants from these research-oriented institutions, including Northwestern and the Third Coast Center for AIDS Research in Chicago, to do some research implementation. So implementation research, I should say, as we're implementing. So all of these came, we went from zero to four, and then we had to really hit the ground running and get this project off the ground. So here are our main strategies that were identified by teens, supported by teens, and are now really being directed by teens like Saadia to help us make sure that we stay true to everything we've talked about so far and moving forward. So we will have a teen-friendly website that will be in English and Spanish, includes a number of important things. Social media, as Saadia mentioned, and then a Discord channel. I'm not sure if everyone is familiar with Discord, but it is an online platform for like discussion and conversation. It's really come out of the gaming community. So a lot of people in the video gaming community do play video games and engage on Discord. It was quite popular with teens. And we wanted to have a space that was kind of a free exchange of ideas and thoughts about PrEP that would be teen moderated. And we hope to launch that in addition to these other things this fall. And then in quote, the real world, what I'm really excited about is the teen idea to do murals. So murals that are urban murals outside, like on buildings and in underpasses by trains. And then inside we can render murals as window clings, something you would put in the front facing window, for instance, of your organization, or wall clings, or painted on walls. But the whole idea is that these would be each unique collaborative works of art that would include our website, a QR code to take you to the website, and then a tagline that focuses on the need for teens to know about PrEP and to learn about PrEP. And then, of course, we would bring all these things to life with various events and activities, and you can't do anything without cute swag. And I saw some MOSAIC t-shirts earlier, which are very inspiring. We need to get our t-shirt game going.
Hi, Jim. So you're like, we're running out of time. Sorry, could you move to the PrEP for Teens vision?
Sure. I'll quickly click through this. So here's a couple of quick spot looks at our websites. And then some mural inspiration. We had a wonderful mural workshop this weekend where these teens at one of our partner agencies came together and they gave us some great ideas about what we were going to do for a mural that will be placed at this in this organization's windows. Super excited about that. And we're going to end here with the vision. I'm going to have Saadia read off both our vision statements.
Chicago teens deserve access to relevant, culturally literate, and tailored information related for PrEP to PrEP for HIV prevention and clear, empowering sexual health and wellness resources beyond HIV. The project envisions a Chicago in which all teens are educated about sexual health, empowered to take charge of their sexual health and overall well-being, and share this information and confidence through art and advocacy.
So thank you so much. We hope to launch in the fall. We will share all this with y'all and would love your feedback. And thank you so much for your time this morning.
Thanks so much, Jim and Saadia. Thank you. We're going to move ahead to the next exciting part of our webinar, which is a panel. And I'm going to hand over to Sasha again. And for, some of you may know that Sasha hosts a podcast called The Drive with Sasha, and it's a platform where young people meet and share their thoughts and experiences. So over to you, Sasha.
Thank you so much, Saiqa. Thank you so much, Bridger. Please, can you move to the next slide? Ladies and gents, I want you to sit back, relax, and allow me and my panelists to take care of you from now up until we meet at destination, which will be Lord knows at what time. Now, before we dive into it, I want to introduce to you my panelists. We have Louie Mercy Katoka. She is a prevention program assistant and a NextGen squad member representing Zambia. And we also have Rubuna Nagai, which is a technical assistant and a NextGen squad member representing Uganda. Next slide, please. We have Adaubi Olisa, which is a pharmacist and NextGen squad member representing Nigeria. And we also have Leo Martinez, I hope I pronounced it correctly. He is 18 years and a printer, a musician, and a musician and an art media design student at the DePaul University in Chicago. And last but not least, we have Saadia Hidari, which is a youth leader and originally from Chicago. So now I'm just going to pose my first question to Adaubi. So Adaubi, what skills, knowledge, and or experiences did you bring to your PrEP project from the beginning?
Thank you, Sasha, and thanks everyone for the great session so far. So before I joined MOSAIC, I supported the EPIKPIF project in Nigeria, which was providing HIV prevention, care, and treatment services to key populations in Bayelsa and Niger State. This project was the first of its kind in both states. I started on that project as an intern for 8 months, and those 8 months were life-changing. I learned about key populations, I worked closely with them, I saw the impact of our work, and that really ignited a passion in me to continue in this space. This meant that I started the MOSAIC project with knowledge on HIV, PrEP, STIs, key population interventions, community engagement, and so on and so forth. And like Sasha said, I'm also a certified pharmacist. So the background knowledge that comes with being a healthcare professional has definitely been an added advantage for me. And then on my work on the KPIF project, I was offered the opportunity to write abstracts and present at international conferences. And this exposed me to public speaking skills. And also through the IAS Youth Ambassador Program, I learned how to communicate with young people across different countries and continents. All these skills have been super relevant to my work on MOSAIC. However, through MOSAIC, I've learned so much more. I can't even imagine what I've learned on Jose, and I'm still learning. Thank you so much.
Oh, yes. Thank you so much, Adobe. I can see comments from the chat saying they'd love to see young people leading such engagement, which brings me to my next question too, but this one is directed to Rubona. Why did you decide to become involved in a PrEP project, and why was it important to you?
Hi, Sasha. Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Sasha, for the opportunity. Yes, so for me, I think joining the PrEP project is finding a space. Most times when we do engagements, when we do projects, it's quite limited from young people. So I wanted to see key representation of young people on PrEP projects, but also holding projects accountable for the engagements of young people, because most times we are always at the implementing stages, we are always at the end time receivers. So I wanted to be part of a project where we start from initial stages, where we know that we started from a particular place, and the programs that have been brought on board are tailored to young people. So for me, I think that is one of the reasons for joining PrEP projects, to see that there is clear engagement of young people on the projects that are being laid out. And also something that I would say that is very important is I didn't have much information on PrEP. So joining a MOSAIC project like this for me gave me a lot of information, especially the new biomedical interventions that have been brought on board. Talk about the ring, talk about CAB. I didn't have much information, but joining MOSAIC has given me a lot of information, which I am able to share with other young people out there. I'm able to answer questions, and I am on the know for everything. So I think that is why I really, really wanted to be part of this amazing project. So it's very important that I am a huge person, and I'm greatly honored to be part of an impact of young people that is changing lives out there. I'm part of a project that is giving opportunity to young people at risk to prevent HIV. That at some point, we as young women will have courage to hold on to the things, especially the biomedical interventions, especially the prevention measures. Looking at the UNAIDS target of 2030, ending HIV by 2030, this is an opportunity for us as young women to take part, but also own up to the interventions as young people. Thank you so much. Over to you, Sasha.
Thank you so much. I heard you speaking about joining MOSAIC and gaining a lot of information. I just want to find out from you, how do you think will be the best way of actually delivering that information to young people in Uganda, for an example?
Yes, so I would speak from a point of I'm on the stage of people who have put up the project. So using the youth advisory board is one of the things that will get information out there, because youth are young people that are the community. Youth are young people that are the stage where information is well disseminated. So having community advisory boards who will hold the project accountable for information, where the project like MOSAIC can give more information, but also results on what they have found out on the different methods. I think these are projects. This is a platform where if a youth advisory committee has information, it's able to give it to other young people and disseminate it. So another thing is the internet. We have the internet. We as young people, NextGen squad members, we use the internet for different things. So we as young people who have the information could use the internet to disseminate this kind of information to other people and other platforms. Like today here, we have a youth engagement. Young people today on this panel, young people today on this webinar are able to share information. So having constant webinars is also a key thing where young people get to give information to other people. And other things that I might have not spoken about that are important that we could use to give information out there. Thank you. Over to you, Sasha.
Thank you so much, Rubona. So everybody listening, you heard, we need more webinars whereby young people are leading. I'm looking at you. So I'm now going to jump over to Mercy Louie Katoka. So Mercy, how can organizations strengthen young people's knowledge and skills to contribute to PrEP projects?
Thank you so much, Sasha, for that question. So I think organizations can strengthen young people's knowledge as well as skills for young people to be able to contribute to PrEP projects, as well as PrEP by providing necessary tools as well as information, and just basically educating young people about PrEP, let young people know what PrEP is and what PrEP programs are there. And you also just want to build the capacity of these young people and ensure that you also provide training as well as leadership opportunities for them to be able to develop skills that will enable them to work in these spaces and just thrive in general and contribute meaningfully and relevantly. Because at the end of the day, we don't just want to have young people. We want young people that are able to contribute meaningfully as well as relevantly to these projects. And I'll just give an example of how we as NextGen Squad members are supported, of course, by the NextGen Squad support team that Mashadi talked about, as well as our supervisors who also serve as mentors. So we are capacitated in such a way that we have capacity building trainings where we learn about CAB PrEP, which is the products that are yet to be introduced into the market. We learn about blogs, abstracts, review journals, and we're also basically just given opportunities where we lead and we facilitate sessions and meetings, inclusive of webinars, just like the webinar that we're attending today. And this just helps us to generally develop and improve our skills, both technical skills and other skills, for us to be able to contribute to various processes, both in country and at the global level, looking at the fact that the MOSAIC project is a global project. And as NGS members, we have really contributed to various processes. We've also reviewed fact sheets and other documents. And in addition, I feel like it's important to also include young people in the design, implementation, as well as the monitoring and evaluation processes, strategies, as well as programs, and just offer roles within the organization that young people can serve. So another example that I can give is how we as the NGS members are not only engaged on the MOSAIC project as youth representatives or as youth advocates, but then we also serve in our various organizations on different roles. We have NGS members that are program assistants. We have NGS members that are research assistants. We have NGS members that are technical officers and all that. And we just participate in various project activities. We've participated in work planning. We've participated in the development of guidelines, national guidelines, and we also just contribute to the different result areas that MOSAIC has. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Louie. I can see from the chat, Jim said, PrEP4Teens is gaining so much info from this webinar. So girls, we are truly leading this project. Louie, just as a quick question, what do you think is the importance of having young people to actually review such materials, your journals, your country guidelines? What do you think is the importance of doing that?
Okay, so it's important for young people to be involved in review processes, guidelines development processes, just to ensure that, for instance, PrEP considerations and in those guidelines. So you want to ensure that even as you are packaging this information, it's user friendly, it's youth friendly, and it's packaged in such a way that it's appealing to the young people. And you also just want to ensure that even in the design of these programs and everything that you want to do that's aiming or targeted at young people is reflective of what the young people want. Because at the end of the day, you don't want to come up with documents and you are cascading them in the community, but then, you know, the documents are not really addressing the problems that young people are facing. So I think that's the whole essence and importance of including young people in these processes. And just like the saying says, young people are the future leaders of tomorrow. I believe we're future leaders of today. And if we are future leaders of today, to create a sustainable future, we have to ensure that young people are included in all these processes for sustainability. Thank you.
I know that's right. I know that's right. Thank you so much, Louis. I'm going to direct this question to Saiqa. Saiqa, what do you think you have gained or are gaining from being part of the creation of the PrEP project?
I think that the creation of the PrEP project is something that has really taught me how to get involved in community. It's built a community for me. When I first was on the project, I was 16 and I did not have a great sexual education from the Chicago public school system. And the PrEP4Teens project allowed me to learn not only about PrEP, but about so many things that I was initially afraid to ask about. I've been open to a community of experts that are willing to answer my questions without a lot of judgment. And I feel that the PrEP project has been important for me to realize how we can do the same for others in the community of Chicago. And it's taught me about how I should consider things that I normally wouldn't consider when if I had started this project, a project similar to PrEP4Teens without the guidance that I have received. One of the things that came up in our meetings that I hadn't considered before was the way we write our logo, how it would impact non-native English speakers. Things like that have become something that have really shaped how I see community mobilization and organization. And I'm really grateful for the PrEP4Teens project for guiding me through all of that.
So if I heard you correctly, you said that PrEP4Teens is not only delivering information in English, but also in other different languages.
Yes, we are trying to release our website in Spanish because we do have a lot of non-native English speakers in the Chicagoland area, specifically Spanish speakers. So it's a great part of the project that I really appreciated us integrating.
Thank you so much, Saiqa. Now, last but not least, Leo, what advice would you give a PrEP project that wants to meaningfully engage a younger generation in their work?
Okay, so basically what I kind of boil down to is a bunch of C's. Confidence in creation, community, connection, and clarification. So basically, creation, sharing, it can be a very scary thing for youth to engage in. It is a very vulnerable part of them, whether it's their writing, their songs, their advocacy, and also being an artist and feedback, it's all a lot. So providing me with examples of the things that they can share is definitely very useful. It is good to use different outlines of things that they can participate in and actively be inviting them to share their thoughts and ideas. This is most likely their first job, at least for me. It was my first paid experience at 15. I had no idea really what I was getting into when it came to the money and involvement side of it. And money, especially for youth, is a very good motivator. So being transparent on how much you're going to get paid, what kind of things that they gain from as far as work experience, this is an amazing thing to add on resumes, especially not many places are hiring writers and artists at such a young age without so much background. So this is an amazing experience for them to get involved and get experience and further on their careers, and emphasizing how that's not just monetary being gained is a great way to keep them engaged. And also encouraging them to talk to their friends and communities on their work, that they'd not just have a, it's not just their work life that they're being involved in. They're being involved in a larger network of people. And teens are most likely to stay engaged when they feel external validation. So continually telling them that their work and what they're doing matters, that their voice in this matters, and the things that they're putting into the world matter. They should feel like they're the ones that understand their demographic more than anyone else. So encouragingly telling them that their voice and what they're sharing, what they're expressing, while vulnerable, is incredibly important to making this project what it is. I think that's how we best engage our youth.
That's great. Thank you so much. Just as a follow-up question, briefly, how were you engaged for you to join this project?
I was first engaged via an Instagram post. I saw a little blurb on my screen and decided to click it because I was, I think I was like saving up for like a skateboard or something like that back then. And I just was very excited about participating and stuff like that. And it slowly started to build, and my role in the project started to build, and I felt more and more, valued, which kept me coming back, kept me sharing my voice.
All right. Thank you so much. Now, I want to pose this question to all of you. I actually have two questions. One is from the chat, and one is, what would you like to see happen as we look towards the future of youth involvement in HIV prevention? This is open to everyone, by the way.
Okay. Hi, Sasha. So just like everyone said, I'll just like to echo what everyone has said. Sebo, Havana, Leo, Louis, everyone. I would love to keep seeing meaningful youth engagement in HIV prevention. Like the previous speaker said, for sustainability, for ownership, and just to give young people the voice that we need to access the services. I would love to keep seeing meaningful youth engagement. The HIV prevention landscape is expanding, and hopefully it will continue to expand as more products are introduced into the market. So I would love to see that through meaningful youth engagement, this HIV prevention market are accessible to every young person that needs them. Right now, there are so many challenges. I see people writing in the chat, age of access, content, and many other challenges that young people face. I would like to see a market that upholds choice by providing the necessary information. We know that low awareness, low knowledge is still a challenge among young people. I would love to see a market that provides the necessary information that all young people need and supports them to make their informed choices. I would love to see a market that reflects and adapts to the preferences of young people. We know that the preferences of young people, the choices of young people are ever changing, and they are really affected by what is going on in the world around us. So I would love to see a market that will easily adapt to those changes to suit the needs of the young people. And lastly, I would like to see a HIV prevention market that demystifies HIV and HIV prevention. For too long, we have attached a lot of stigma and discrimination to HIV and HIV prevention. I just want to see a market where open and honest conversations are had about HIV prevention, where people can openly come out and say, oh, I'm taking PrEP, or oh, I'm taking ARVs, and they are not shunned and they are not stigmatized for it. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Now, my last question is, are parents involved in decision-making for PrEP under 18s in the U.S.?
I would say it really depends. There is a lot of, legally you can get PrEP with knowledge of your provider. It is underneath, sexual health care that you have access to legally. But at the same time, there is a lot of roadblocks. For me, my father, his first language is not English. So a lot of the language to communicate and need a necessity for this isn't always accessible between me, a first English speaker, and him, a first Spanish speaker. So it's really important for there to be more bilingual words and things in Japanese accessible so we can have these conversations so parents can be more involved in the process.
Thank you so much, Leo. Now, this is my final question. And also, it's open to everyone. Can young people hold the researchers plus the research community accountable for the research that they are doing?
Okay, so I'll go. I think, yes, young people can hold researchers accountable for the research that they're doing. And I think it all just draws us back to ensuring that young people are also included on these research teams. And just like I earlier mentioned, and of course, the MOSAIC has the Catalyst Study, and this Catalyst Study has engaged young people, not only young people that are part of the NextGen squad, but then there's also young people that have been engaged as part of the community youth advisory boards. So those young people can also just help the researchers as well as the research study be accountable. They can hold the researchers accountable of the various promises that they have to fulfill, and just ensuring that young people's needs are put or taken into consideration, even as the research is being conducted. And at the end of the day, I feel after a research is done, the end product should show or be inclusive of or reflective of what young people's voices were, or what young people's highlights were even during that research process. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Louie. So now we've already dived into the Q&A, whereby Saiqa and I will be moderating the session. And I have a question from the chat, which is, for young people seeking PrEP services, what can programs or providers do to make these services youth-friendly?
I'd say with a lot of the stigma that's going around about HIV, having things like handhelds that people can just take without having a direct confrontation with the provider can really help start those initial conversations, or something that people can give their friends. It's a great way to maybe help like those shyer members start getting involved.
Sanisha, I'd like to also add on to what Leo just mentioned. So I think for serving young people, it's not a one-size-fits-all for us. We as young people have different needs at different times at different levels. So for you to have youth-friendly services, you need to understand what are the needs of the young people. For you to give a youth-friendly service, what are the needs of the young people in that particular place? It might be different for Uganda. It might be different for Zambia or Eswatini. But we need to find out from the young people what are the things that they need, what are the things that they would want. So I'll give an example of a clinic. We might come to a boardroom and we are 20, and we about 30 years, and then we align things that we think young people would use as youth friendly, or we think that are youth friendly for young people. But then engaging the young people themselves, then we know that these are things that are specific to what young people need, but also the program has been arranged in a way that young people are understanding the needs that they are having at this particular time. So when they come to the facility, we know that maybe they want privacy, maybe they want a particular clinic for young people, which might not come out in an adult clinic. So it's very important that we continue to engage young people to understand their particular needs, also to be able to put them on ground as we continue to implement. Over to you, Sasha.
Thank you so much. I just want to say that all the presenters can come on the camera because we've opened the Q&A to actually everyone. So, and also, even though we are almost concluding, we would actually love to hear your feedback. So just pop everything in the chat and we'll get to read them. And I can see that saying, yes, Rubuna, I agree, young people are not homogeneous. So we truly are, you know, remarkable. We are amazing. I'll just have to ask my co-host if she has any questions that would like to pose to any other presenters.
So I there's a question in the chat around mental health and whether the package for the Catalyst study includes mental health. So I just wanted to maybe take the opportunity to respond to that. So just to remind us, the Catalyst study is happening in 5 different countries in very different contexts. And the study is being implemented in Ministry of Health, government facilities, which are PEPFAR supported. So the mental health package varies quite a lot from country to country. And during the Catalyst study, we'll be documenting referrals and looking at what the mental health needs are, as well as
identifying ways of strengthening referrals and response. So I just wanted to add that in terms of the questions. Can I encourage people to put their Q&A in the chat if we have other questions? We had a question about the issue of parental consent, and I think this can be quite a barrier. And perhaps to the NGS squad in different countries, we've heard from the US just on how young people are beginning to engage with parents and other key stakeholders in the community. I know it's been a big focus of the community engagement in preparation for the Catalyst study. Would any of the panelists like to just talk about experience with engaging with parents and also maybe sharing some of the challenges?
I just want to share a little bit about parents. So I'll speak for Uganda. We have a particular way parents look at us. We are expected to be, I'll call it, have particular values, the traditions, the norms still hold us accountable for the things that we do. So at some point, a 15-year-old is not expected to be sexually active. Yes? So a 15-year-old, 16, you're still in school. A parent doesn't expect you to be sexually active. So it's quite tough that a young person will surely be there to tell a parent about what they are doing, especially with PrEP, because some of the parents don't even know what PrEP is. So there is still a lot of work around information sharing that needs to be done out there. So that is one of the things, that there is still a lot of bias, that why would my child be using PrEP and why are they going for sexual activity? So it's more promiscuity that a young person is, or a young girl is using PrEP. So it's quite complicated that our parents are actually on board for this. They could support other communities, but you as a particular parent, when you consult a particular parent on this intervention, they would rather tell you, maybe my daughter could use this, but I don't want to get to know about it. Maybe let them use it. So I think that is why we have choice now, that I can use a product without the knowledge of my parent or my partner, so that I can use a ring without the knowledge of my parent or my partner. But this is something that we can work on to bring parents on board, but it will take some time. But truly, truly speaking, parents are still very biased about their young girls using PrEP. Over to you.
Thank you. Would anyone else like to comment?
Oops. Our connection is unstable.
Yeah, I'm picking hands.
Thanks. Thanks,
Adobe.
Yeah, thanks, Ruben. Thanks, Saiqa. So just reflecting on Havana's and Instable's presentation, they mentioned that the Catalyst study has community advisory boards. And one of the take-home lessons was that parents are included in those community advisory boards. And because parents are included in those community advisory boards, they attend meetings, they contribute to how the study is being rolled out. So that has increased community acceptance. That has helped to reduce these challenges that Rubuna has mentioned. Like Rubuna said, engaging parents is key. We need to get these parents to know what is the scenario on ground, what are we seeing around incidents, and how are we trying to help? We're not encouraging promiscuity in any way, but we're giving these young people a chance to protect themselves, because these parents are not there when young people are making the choices that they make. So we can only help parents to see better why we're trying or how we're trying to protect their children and help them stay healthy and make healthy choices. Thank you.
Thank you so much, everybody. From what from the draft with Saiqa, I heard that young people want to review such materials because they know that it'll be useful for another person in a different village. And also, it's okay. It's better to engage young people in platforms where they are found. Like for an example, TikTok, Instagram, where Leo actually saw the advert. So if you want to engage young people, engage them in a language that will specifically speak to them and they will get to understand. And also, it is also better to get a sexual reproductive health information from a young person because we're also relating to the same challenges that we are focusing on. And with that said, I would like to hand over back to Saiqa.
Right. So thank you very much. I think this brings our PrEP learning network for this week to a close. Can we go to the next slide, please? Great. And so I just wanted to remind us that the MOSAIC Global PrEP Learning Network takes place quarterly. And our next session is this December. So please follow us online or join the mailing list so you can have the latest information on the next PLN date and the time and the topic. And also that all webinars are recorded and shared with the slides on PrepWatch. You can find additional MOSAIC tools and information on the upcoming webinars on PrepWatch. And I'm going to thank all our presenters and hand over to Saiqa to close us out.
Thank you so much, Saiqa. There you have it. A big thank you for taking the time to join in today's PLN, which is PrEP Learning Network. I am very honored to have shared this platform with all of the presenters. You all are very inspirational. And to my lovely co-hosts, thank you so much for being so awesome. And I love and respect you wholeheartedly. And to all of you, from this heart to yours is one love. Take care of yourself and those around you.
And we just want to end by saying, stay curious.
Stay passionate.
And keep advancing the frontiers of knowledge.
Mwah.
Bye.